Hey everybody, happy Saturday night. It's so, my goodness, we're going on 2.5, 3 weeks, soon to be 4, of what's going on in this pandemic. And I know some of you are very anxious, some of you are worried, some of you are isolated, some of you are alone, some of you feel panicked, some of you begin to feel hopeless. I understand. I've been talking to a lot of my patients, and the emotions are all over the place, from people who've been suicidal because they just don't see an end in sight, to people, mostly my introverts, who sort of like it. What I want to begin to talk to you about is mental hygiene. But before I do that, let me give you an update on my parents. I've just gotten so much love and so many prayers for them and for me and for my family. And on Thursday, they came home from the hospital. And my mom had actually tested negative. So she tested positive, and then days later, that's what happens with the test they're currently using. She tested negative. Hello from Ecuador. How exciting. Thank you for watching. My dad is now 2 days fever-free. And in order for you to consider not contagious, you really need to be 3, and some people think 7 days seizure-free. And he's still tired, coughing, not quite himself, but so much better than a week ago when they went into the hospital. So I'm hopeful. And, you know, when you have parents that are 88 and 90, every day you have them is a blessing. And during this time, where you bring your attention determines how you feel. So let me say that again. Where you bring your attention determines how you feel. And when they were in the hospital and I couldn't visit, I mean, you know, you can imagine, my mind is going to the worst place. But I also have been teaching people how to manage their minds for a very long time. And that was so helpful for me. I mean, when you're sad, it's important, it's okay to feel sad, but then you have to do something with it that helps you rather than hurts you. And in my book, Feel Better Fast and Make It Last, I talk about how whenever you're going through anxiety or depression or grief or trauma, there are things you can do to help you feel good now and later, versus now, but not later. And so we just cooked an amazing dinner. I should have done the live chat because I did the halibut and it was so good. And I have a marinade that I stole from somebody, I don't remember, but it's basically olive oil, ground up bay leaves, salt, pepper, garlic, and lemon, and then let it sit for anywhere from 30 minutes to 2 hours, depending on how prepared you are, and then cook it on the stove. It was so delicious, along with some steamed spinach. And then, you know, you can go for the ice cream and ruin the whole thing, or you can go with a little bit of dark chocolate and I'm going to pick dark chocolate. Why? Because I love myself. You know, I do the right thing, not because I should do it, but because I want to be healthy. And I happen to be married to somebody I'm very fond of. And so if I want to be clear-headed for the next 3 or 4 decades, then I have to be making good choices. So thank you for all the love. No, not chocolate ice cream. So let's start talking about mental hygiene. I think this is the smartest thing I've written. When I was on Dr. Phil this week, we talked about it. Mental hygiene is just as important as washing your hands. You have to disinfect your thoughts. You have to disinfect your thoughts. And you've heard me say, kill the ants, the automatic negative thoughts that steal your happiness. So, you know, I'm not sure when people are counting the pandemic started. I mean, it started in November in China, as far as we know. But here in the United States, it was March 10th, and I was in my bathroom, all packed, ready to go to New York. And I got a call. So I was going to be on the Mel Robbins show. Mel Robbins has a nationwide syndicated television show. And she had come to the clinic and we had scanned her and we had talked about a lot of other stories we were going to talk about on the show. I mean, it's basically going to be about my work and my new book, The End of Mental Illness. And I'm in the bathroom getting ready basically to go downstairs and go to the airport. And the producer called and she was so sad that they were gonna close the building and they had to cancel my episode. And part of me was really sad. But I had been flying around the country the week before. And so hearing about this, I was sort of okay with it. And now what I realized after the next couple of days in New York, I was super grateful that I didn't have to get on a plane and do that, even though, you know, I know it would hurt the publicity for The End of Mental Illness. So for me, I count March 10th. Is sort of the beginning when things really got dicey. So, you know, if you think of it that way, we're sort of going into week 4 and week 3, it's stay at home here in California. And so I know some of you are anxious, some of you are scared, some of you are bored. The isolation is really getting to you. And as I sat around the table with my nieces, tonight we're going to talk about part 1 of mental hygiene. And I think this is so important. It's know what you want. You've just been given the gift of a lot more time for many of us. And what are you going to do with it? Are you going to worry and be angry and upset and watch the news 24/7? Please don't do that. It's going to make you sick emotionally. Or are you going to go, I have this gift. What am I going to do with it? And what it reminds me, so some of you know, I was in the Army. I was in the Army for 10 years on active duty and then 6 years in the reserves. And I was an infantry medic, and that's actually where my love of medicine was born. But thank God for me, it was 1972, Vietnam was still raging, and I was sent to Europe. And I spent 3 years living in Germany and loved Germany. But when you're isolated, in a foreign country where you don't speak the language, I shared a room with six other people, and they complained, they were negative, and they spent their evenings smoking pot. And I'm like, no. Just personally, I've never been a fan of feeling foggy or feeling out of control. Now, I know not everybody is like me, but I'm like, so what can I do to make good use of the 3 years I'm going to be here? And I started college when I was there. I actually got a year done at the University of Maryland. They had an extension campus in Germany where I was stationed. And it's actually that first year, because I never thought I was very smart in high school, mostly because I was distracted, played football, and worked full-time. Not full-time, but like 20 hours a week. I worked in my dad's grocery store. And I just had a goal of let me make the next part of my life even better. So I loved my work during the day as an infantry medic, and then I got myself retrained as an x-ray technician and had my own x-ray department and a little dispensary. But it was taking the time I had and doing something important with it. And so as we sat around the table with Chloe, our 16-year-old, Tana, my wife, and our two nieces, I'm like, we have all of April, and we're likely going to have May. What are you going to do with it? And, you know, initially there's the grumbling. Oh, Laura, that's so cool. You attended the University of Maryland in Germany. That is wonderful. I had some of the best teachers. So what are you going to do between now and June? And I'm hoping you're anxious enough to do the right thing. And so we took a drive today and saw my mother-in-law, who has been isolated. And even with her, we wore a mask and gloves, right? Because we have anxiety. And we don't know that either of us have the antibodies to COVID-19. It's one of the hardest things about this. You don't know who's been exposed and who hasn't. But I want you to have enough anxiety that you do the right things as far as social distancing and being really thoughtful about where you put your hands. Now, I know you just saw me brush my face, and I keep trying not to, but my hands are clean. I did the dishes at night. And for all of you guys who think doing the dishes is beneath you, I read an article where both Jeff Bezos and Bill Gates do the dishes. So get over it. You know, there's the richest, most powerful people in the world, and they're not above doing the dishes. Anyways, my hands are clean. One of the big things I've learned being a psychiatrist over the last 35, 40 years, I decided to be a psychiatrist 41 years ago, is all healing, all success starts by knowing what you want. So as far as mental hygiene goes, what do you want? And I have an exercise that I've shared with so many of my patients, and it's just sort of standard for me. When I start to see a new patient, I have them fill out a form and do this exercise called the one-page miracle. on one piece of paper or one computer page, just one, not 10, I want you to write out, what do you want? Everything starts there. If you're depressed, what do you want? Well, I want to feel better. If you're addicted, what do you want? I want to be free from my addiction. And I have you do it in a very structured way. What do you want in your relationships, in your work, in your money, in your physical, emotional, and spiritual health? What do you want? And I do this very specifically because what I've learned is burnout happens. So I've been at this 40 years and I've never been burned out as a psychiatrist. I love my job and I love so much about it. But why have I not got burned out? Because I have balance. And I actually wrote a book in 1999, I actually wrote the first version of it in 1986, called The Sabotage Factor, How to Get Out of Your Own Way. And then Warner Books published it as Don't Shoot Yourself in the Foot. So very early in my career, I learned that if you're going to be successful, if you're going to beat the pandemic, if you're going to get a job back, if you're going to manage your money, it all starts with knowing what you want, which is a frontal lobe function. The front third of your brain is called the executive brain, because it's sort of like the boss at work. For those of you old enough to remember Pinocchio, it's Jiminy Cricket in Pinocchio. What was Jiminy Cricket? Pinocchio's conscience. What did Jiminy Cricket do? Helped Pinocchio get his goal. And so what I would love for you to do tonight is actually do the one-page miracle. I'm going to walk you through it. And so on one piece of paper, write down what you want. And this exercise you can actually find in my newer book, Feel Better Fast and Make It Last. I tend to put it in most of my books because it's just so foundational. One page miracle. What do you want in your relationships? With your partner, if you have one, with your parents, with your kids, and with your friends. What do you want? And with my wife, I'm very clear what I want. I want to have a kind, caring, loving, supportive, passionate relationship. I always want that. So I write it, I look at it, I think about it, and it's burned into my brain. And I always want that. I don't always feel like that. And I'm sure you don't either. And now you're in the middle of a pandemic and whoever you're with, it's like, you know, I'm pretty convinced when this is over 9 months from now, there are going to be a whole bunch more babies because people have more time and there's going to be more divorce because people are like going, no, I don't want to do this with this person for the rest of my life. But I do. And so if you want a great relationship, if you want a great relationship, you have to define it. Define what you want. Write it down. What do you want at work? You know, I'm the CEO for, we have 8 clinics and also the CEO of BrainMD, our supplement company. We have 260 employees. I mean, it's sort of a big deal. And I want to be a good leader. I mean, I think about that all the time. I want, when it comes to September, and this is sort of behind us, I hope, I want to be proud of how I supported the people that basically, you know, make my vision and the vision of Amen Clinics and BrainMD work. And so I think about that. And yes, you have to think of the finances, but you know, what I really think, how can I support the team that helps me do what I love doing? So when it comes to work, I want you to be really clear with what you want. Now, there's one question from Carmen. It's like, well, how do you deal with the unknown? You know, there are certain things you can do and there's certain things you can't do. Whenever I worry and I can't sleep, and that happens to me, I have a journal by my bed. I mean, it's here it is. Just like a simple composition journal that I have by my bed. And I write down what I'm worried about. And then I write down, well, what can I do about it? And what can't I do about it? And that way, from a mental hygiene standpoint, I am focused on what's possible, not what's terrible. What do you want in your money? And this is a terrible time with businesses, you know, not being able to work and life being so uncertain. It's a terrible time, which means you want to kick your frontal lobes into gear and go, okay, how much do I have? How much can I spend? And where's help for me? And there are lots of resources, and you want to do whatever you can to activate them. Again, within what you can do, not what you can't do. What do you want for you, for your physical health? And I'm convinced more than ever, if you focus, because that's what we're talking about, if you focus that these 2 months, or whatever, how long it is, that these 2 months you can get healthy. If you keep your mind on the right thing, if you eat as healthy as possible. I was at Trader Joe's today and they didn't have a lot of things. But whenever I went to put something in the basket, I'm like, is this good for my brain or bad for it? And then it's compared to what? You know, if they don't have fresh organic pomegranate seeds, it's like, well, what can I get? Some frozen fruit that actually is way better than the ice cream. So is it good for my brain or bad for it compared to what? Now, why do I do that? Because I have very clear physical goals for myself. I want to be a certain weight. Why? Because I tend to come from fat people. My dad gets mad at me when I say that, but it's true. I actually tested my genes and it said I had a 2/3 chance of being obese. And I'm one of 7 and a couple of my siblings are, but I'm not. Why? Because I don't give in to the behaviors making it likely to be so. That would really bother me, because I published 2 studies. I'm about to publish a 3rd study. It's actually truly terrifying. As your weight goes up, virtually every area of your brain goes down in function and blood flow. Oh no! So now is the time to watch your calories. Now the quality of your food matters. The quantity matters too. So it's not either or, it's both. So if you need to lose 10 pounds, 20 pounds, 50 pounds, imagine what you could do in the next 2 months if you focused on eating the right thing. And whenever I gain a couple of pounds, I start counting calories. It's not hard. I have a little note thing on my phone and I just start writing down everything I put in my mouth, including the almond milk cappuccino I make for my wife every day. And I know exactly how many calories in it. It's 30 calories a cup. And if I end up having two, that's 60 calories. So write it down and give yourself, you know, whatever's the right thing for you. If I give myself 1500 calories in 2 weeks, I'll have lost 2 pounds and then I'll be happy. And people go, oh, I don't weigh myself. And it's like, if you can't change what you do not measure. That's why we do brain imaging at Amen Clinics, because it's like, how do you know unless you look? I never want to be in the dark. So what do I want for my physical health? I want a healthy blood sugar. In the end of mental illness, I go through the 11 major risk factors that steal your mind. And so, for example, the mnemonic is bright minds, is I want healthy blood flow, which means I exercise 6 out of 7 days this week. I'm very happy with myself. R is retirement and aging. The older I get, the more serious I have to be. Learn something new. Working on the piano. I'm also teaching table tennis to my niece. We had a fun time today. The I is inflammation. If you're eating all that sugar, it's causing inflammation in your body. And one of the things that kills people with the COVID-19 virus is an inflammation storm that it can trigger. And so I take omega-3 fatty acids every day, along with brain curcumins that BrainMD makes. Curcumin decreases inflammation. I also take probiotics because that getting your gut right decreases inflammation. G is genetics, know your risk factors. Mine's heart disease and obesity, and I don't have heart disease and I'm not obese because I'm serious about preventing them. H is head trauma. I never do anything to put me at risk. If I'm on a ladder, it's a really sturdy ladder. T is toxins, and I'm so worried that all the cleaning products were just doing nothing but putting toxins on our skin, and whatever goes on your skin goes in your body. So using healthy cleaning products, Tana and I just did a Brain Warriors Way podcast. So if you like my live chats, Tana and I have 600 Brain Warriors Way podcasts you can listen to for free. We just did one, I think it just released this week, with Kelly Vlahakis, who is the president and CEO of Earth Friendly Products. They make the Ecos brand in your store. So detergent, laundry detergent, dishwasher soap, hand soap. I mean, they just make great products. And I support her work. Actually, I went to that company and we created a brain healthy company. So I spent 6 months with them. But know what you want physically, know what you want mentally. And for me, I want to be present, right? Because if you're in the past with regret or the future with fear, you're going to be either depressed, past with regret, or anxious, future with fear. So I want to be present and I want to be happy and I want to be purposeful because that makes me happy and I want to be connected. And happiness isn't a nice thing, it's a critical thing. Just think, if you were raised by an unhappy parent, how damaging that was to your psyche. So wanting to be happy is not sort of a bonus, it's important. Now, my experience, the happiest people are those who are purposeful, that they have a reason to get up and a reason to make a difference in the lives of other people. So if I'm going to be happy, I need to know what I want, and then I need to have discipline around my habits. And I talk a lot about tiny habits. It's something I learned from BJ and Linda Fogg. Smallest thing I can do today that will make the biggest difference. Hi, Joanne. So nice to see you live. Give Ben a hug for me. So the tiny habits start every day. And this is even when my parents are in the hospital. Today is going to be a great day. Because then my unconscious mind will find why it's going to be a great day. And then before I go to bed at night, what went well today? So for me, I have a ritual. I put my head on the pillow, I say a prayer, and then I'm like, what went well today? And my favorite day this week was Tuesday because I was most worried about my mom and dad and I couldn't see them. And I talked to their doctor and I was also on Dr. Phil that day. Now I had filmed it the week before, but it came and she could watch me afterwards, and she said that was the best medicine, that I got to watch you, and that was how I could visit her that day. And before I went to bed, I just thought about what a beautiful moment that is. But if you don't do that every day, if you just don't go, what went well, you're going to miss the beautiful moments in your life. Where you bring your attention determines how you feel. And in the middle of a pandemic, if you have CNN or Fox going nonstop in the background, you're gonna feel terrible. And, you know, I suppose they don't do it purposefully, but they know you pay attention to scary news, to negative news, way more than you pay attention to positive news, happy news, hopeful news. And I want you to develop some discipline about what you allow in your mind. It's just absolutely critical. So I've talked about relationships and work and a little bit about money, physical health, mental health. Well, what about spiritual health? Which is, why the heck do you care? Why are you on the planet? What's your deepest sense of meaning and purpose? And, you know, are you connected to God? Are you connected to your grandchildren? Are you connected to making a difference in the planet? What matters to you? All of us are spiritual beings. And the research actually shows people who go to church of whatever stripe get better much faster when they struggle with depression. And now I know we can't go physically, tomorrow's Palm Sunday, but we can totally go virtually. And I recommend that everybody do that. For the last 10 years, I've been a member of Saddleback Church in here in Southern California. They actually have 19 or 20 campuses all around the world, Hong Kong, Philippines, Buenos Aires, Berlin, and online. And, you know, whether it's Saddleback or any other church, your church, if you belong to one, you totally can be a part of your group. Whatever it is, we need to be socially isolated, physically socially isolated. We do not need to be emotionally and relationally isolated. That is really important. So whether it's FaceTime or video conferencing, or on the phone with your kids, with your grandkids, you need to make a discipline of that and be connected. So, mental hygiene principle number one, know what you want. And once you do your one-page miracle, once you know what you want, I want you to post it and put it up where you can see it every day. And then take a picture if you want and post it here so I can see them. And then what I want you to do is ask yourself every day, does my behavior get me what I want? And it's not selfish, because if you do this in a balanced way, you're going to find your level of success, either in your marriage or your money or your work or your physical, emotional, or spiritual health, going to go way up. Why? Because you've told your brain what you want, you'll help you get it. But if you just tell your brain regret or fear, then what you're going to get is depression or anxiety. So mental hygiene, number one, know what you want. Ask yourself, does your behavior... I'm so grateful for you. So actually helps me sane, being connected to people in my community. Thanks for the hearts. I will see you soon.